Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me here. I'm very pleased to be in England, especially in Cambridge. The atmosphere is really, I think, just the place helps moving physics and philosophy up, I hope. So, can future measurement affect the present? Although this issue is very important, I think now there are more important things. So I want to let you, let you know that no one will miss a very important match will happen when it will be on Friday. I would like that this will be the story. Unfortunately, future measurement cannot do this. I cannot change any reality now. I cannot bring Israel to finals or any other country. So I would try to see what can be done. I think there are some possibilities of changing present by future measurement, but not like this. Although even this is very problematic, I really believe in block universe. So even my future measurements are already there. So if I'm now in present, I probably cannot change. All past exists, future exists, everything, all my measurements exist. So maybe the question is not relevant. I believe it is relevant. I believe even if I believe in block universe, I think free will is very helpful concept. And it's necessary concept if we want to talk about science. From my point of view, to talk about scientific theory, you have to assume a box. Small box, big box. And about this box, you want to make a theory. Now, you want to assume that there is a free agent which can do whatever he wants about this object, any disturbance. Now, the object, probably two particles, also very important, but for our issues, I think we need to put an observer inside, because we want to understand present, what is it? It's our present, it's present for us, what he thinks. We can do whatever we want to this observer. We can put inside objects, we can prepare it in any way, we can disturb it when we want, and we can observe it all the time. So there is a free will to make this interaction, measurements, disturbance, preparation. There are some still limitations. We cannot in the future put an object inside the box, so it will remain in the past. The object which we'll put, like this bee, should fulfill physical laws. So the same unitary which brought it in, if we'll go backward in time, will take it out. But so given this, given our era of time, maybe external era of time, we are supposed to be free to do whatever we want. We can make measurements of this, and depending on measurement, make disturbance, observe, and take any operations. So the question, given this, can we change present? But I think the important question is, what is present? The question, my first future measurement, I think more or less clear what it is. And then I say, can I affect the present? What do I mean by present? In fact, I believe that the only reality is a wave function, and there is psi. The wave function going forward. If this is present, then the answer is no, and should finish the talk here. If description of reality now, it's a wave function going from the past, no way to change this wave function by any action at future. However, I'm working in two-state vector formalism all the time. And in fact, I say that objects are described by two-state vector. And if object described by two-state vectors, then obviously I can affect the future wave function, which going backward in time. I can decide which measurement I will do. I cannot prepare or post-select a given wave function going backward in time, but I can decide which set of possible wave functions, depending on which measurement I will do. So there is this obvious idea that I can decide which measurement. The measurement will have one of the set of the outcomes, and this will tell which phi I will go backward. So which two-state vector will describe the present? This two-state vector, I will say they are really relevant for microscopic particles. Now I will kind of have a talk inside the talk. I will try to persuade you that it's really for us, talking about microscopic particles, it's really a good idea to talk about two-state vector description, not one vector description or anything else. So, and I will talk about experimental work, in fact, in support of the idea that the present should be described by psi phi. And if it's described by psi phi, of course, we have some way to influence the present by deciding on future measures. It was done with the help of two students, Shimshon Barat in Tel Aviv. Okay. The work is asking photons, because about the past, but really one can say present, because I decide about future measurements, so now it's really, if I have the future measurement, so now it's really a present, and since I talk about future measurements, so the past of these photons is the present which I'm talking about. And one of the very important question, what was the past of the photon? Maybe you'll take single photon source, going through Mach Zehnder interferometer. In fact, photons didn't tell me about this. There is a simpler experiment. We take the beam splitter out. And here I think photon told me where they were. One may think that this is kind of a very trivial setup and you don't need much to think about it. But I think this is not so obvious. If you look on different approaches, there are different answers. If I be kind of textbook von Neumann, we have a wave function going all over. The wave function was all, photon was everywhere until it collapsed here. If we are Bohmian, then in fact it will have this strange trajectory. Here, without almost any kind of reasonable cause, it will change. It will move to make a 90 degrees turn. Now, Wheeler says something reasonable. He says the trajectory of the photon, the path of the photon, it was on the path which it could pass, could take. And here, since there is no beam splitter here, the only one, it's this one. So, I think to choose between all these conceptual possibilities, one to have some criteria. And things which one we can take as possibilities, for example, if we know it started here, ended here, we say the photon was everywhere where we could find it in non-demolition measurements, which today technology maybe slowly come to the possibility to make a non-demolition measurement of a photon and let it go. And clearly, this Wheeler's path will correspond to this criteria. Criteria which I like much more, and I will talk about it more, is that every particle which goes around leaves some trace on environment, however weak. So I believe that the particle was where it left a weak trace. Maybe another idea that how I know that my photon was not here. One of the ideas is that if I do put here something, I will do nothing to the photon. However, if I put something here, I do something for a photon. So the question, if I can affect the photon, if I put a kind of piece of glass and it will shift my photon up, I put it here, it will be shifted. I will put it here, it will not be shifted. So again, I will say it probably was shifted. But essentially, I will use more or less this idea with some, together with this idea, to try to make an experiment and ask photons what they can tell where they were in this kind of experiment. So let's consider again Wheeler. If we look on Wheeler, it started here, it continued, then we take beam splitter out, comes here. Let's say we found it in this place. Wheeler will say it was here because it couldn't come any other way. However, now if we'll put a beam, Wheeler will also say the same in a different experiment. We can make this which pass experiment. The standard one is taking out a beam splitter. But now I consider another one. Let's take out a mirror. It's also a which pass experiment because the only way to come to this detector when there is no mirror is this way. So Wheeler will say, oh, this is the path of the photon also in this case. And something which will be important and experiment in fact which will do, I will complicate it a little. Instead of just taking out this mirror, I will create here another Mach Zehnder interferometer and I tune it in such a way that nothing come down. So I will say that again, photon cannot go through this pass and reach this detector. So this photon was here. Now, if we look on again, textbook, von Neumann, it goes here, we take it out, it goes here. Now a miracle happens, we have a collapse. And from now on, all the waves disappear. But we don't have this story. We don't use this maybe colloquial or naive approach of Wheeler. Von Neumann doesn't try to say that the photon was in this trajectory. What he says that before it was all over, and now it's here. So essentially, the past was everywhere here, and then here. So it's a different picture. At least these two different pictures, well, I can try to kind of ask photons, which picture you prefer? Which big picture you will say it's more reasonable? And the way how I devise the experiment is the following. I got photons here, but on the way I told them something. If they gave me this information, so I knew that they were in a place where they got this information. The information was the frequency of wiggling of mirror. I wiggled this mirror, and when this mirror wiggled, of course the beam goes up and down. And this was not a normal detector, it was a quad cell detector, which measures, it was two detectors essentially, not quad, here. And I measured the current, the difference of the current, up and down. So of course, when the beam goes up and down, I got the signal, sinusoidal signal, and I put it in an analyzer, and I saw this, the frequency of my wiggling. So this experiment tells me that clearly that the photon was here. Student put this frequency, I didn't know about this. I saw it here on the detector. So clearly the photons which came here had to pass through this mirror. Because I could, how they would know this frequency? Then I looked on this Mach Zehnder interferometer and I put different frequency here and here. And I saw both. One can naively say, oh, the photons went two places. But on my experiment, we had 10 to the 13 photons to create this picture. So it's possible that maybe half of them went one way, half of them went another way. So I really don't know which. But I know that some of the photons clearly were here and here. Otherwise, no way to get these two peaks with frequencies which were known only in these locations. So then I took this beam splitter out. Just first I checked that if I close this, and then it was naturally, if when I block this, this frequency disappeared. I blocked another one, another frequency disappeared. So now I could come to this experiment which I was interested. I put frequency both here and here. And not very surprisingly, this frequency didn't show up. I saw only frequency of this mirror. So this kind of tell us which picture is correct or which picture is better. Put these two experiments, essentially the same experiment. If I analyze according to Wheeler, Wheeler said it couldn't come in another way, only by this way here. So it was near this mirror. It was not this mirror near mirror A, because no way to come from A to my detector. However, textbook says it was everywhere. The power spectrum says it was just there. So it's helpful to say that Wheeler is correct and textbook are incorrect. It is not that they're completely incorrect. You can have a more complicated story, entanglement or whatever, and talk about textbooks. But if you want to talk about where was the photon, and in fact most textbooks will say don't discuss this, you are not supposed. If you want to talk about photons being in some places, then it doesn't work. And Wheeler works. So Wheeler works, and this was almost my first experimental work, so I wanted to continue and to see and to be sure that Wheeler is correct. So this experiment, and I repeat it, and I saw in a Max Zehnder interferometer, Wheeler will say it could be in every place, and we see both of them, so Wheeler is correct. And if we block one of them, Wheeler will say, okay, not because of the block, there is no way for a photon to come through here. So this frequency should disappear, and it disappeared. And Wheeler is correct. To tune one interferometer, it's not a big challenge. So I decided to play a little more, and we put interferometer inside interferometer. We put 2/3 of the beam here and 1/3 of the beam here, such that here this was 50-50, so it was 1/3 here, 1/3 here, and 1/3 here. And again, the 2/3 come out, and we arranged it, it was exact constructive interference everywhere. And we wanted to know where was the photon everywhere in this inside interferometer. So every mirror we had, we wiggled. Every mirror was wiggled with different frequency. And the result was not particularly surprising, because 1/3 of the beam here, 1/3 here, and 1/3 here, we got equal signal with frequencies of mirrors A, B, and C. These were 4 times bigger, because we have beam twice as big, and the Fourier transform, really, power spectrum give us square. So we get, here we get signal in this of this frequency and this frequency, the signals were, we saw them, so it was very convincing. Wheeler says that the photon can be everywhere.
Because of this imbalance that you have 2/3 of the power on the upper part and 1/3 down on the last beam speed, that you must have something going down also.
No, this was 2:1 and this was 1:2.
This one was not a 50-50.
This is not. Like the big interferometer was 2:1.
Okay, so you draw all of them the same, but they are not all the same.
So this is 50-50, and these are 2:1 and 1:2. This. Okay, so the Wheeler, great. But then we did one more experiment. Essentially, it wasn't a new experiment, it was the same experiment. We took this device as it was working, and we just shifted a little this mirror, moved it a little. So essentially putting a pi phase in this inner interferometer. As a result, instead of constructive interference here, we got destructive interference here. Complete destructive interference. So everything come out here. Everything, maybe it's we succeeded to get 98.5% here. This was, I believe, in the laboratories which will kind of smile on our result, but this was good enough to get the point. Now, I didn't show what we got, and if here there are people who never heard about this work, I would like that they will tell me what they think, which result we got.
C.
Yes, but clearly it's very reasonable that we get C, because it looks like it's the only option. But since I give a talk and I draw this, then something that it should be somewhat different.
The surprise is that you let us think it's different, what is C?
too sophisticated. So. So any suggestion except C? That I think it's very persuasive that it should be C. This Wheeler will tell us it should be C, because it cannot go through this. No way. Of course, maybe we have this small leakage, so maybe we get some small 1%, but I'm talking about a big signal. So is there any reason to get some other?
If I know the answer, I'm allowed to say.
Until and I think I gave about this. Usually, I gave about more than 5 talks about this. Maybe even more. No one predicted the outcome. Although after it they say, oh, it's obvious, some of them, but no one told what I'm supposed to see.
Would you give some money for the ones that guess correctly?
In fact, I was just in Bell conference and I was allowed only to give a poster, and I gave a poster with this, and it was written, everyone tells me the answer gave, will get a free drink, and I think Larson got a free drink. I don't know if he knew about this before, but... Okay, so this is what we got. And this, of course, C is, we got the C, but the same size we got also A and B. And what's maybe even more surprising, A and B were present, but not E. But it looks like the photon to come to here through A and B had to be at E. Maybe also in F. No E, no F. So, something. So Wheeler said it should be on a lower one, so he's wrong. And so photons told that the Wheeler is wrong. And the textbook's also wrong. The textbook, this is where the forward wave function, E should appear and F should not appear. But we knew already that the textbooks are not a good idea to rely on. So, what is the explanation of this strange picture? What is right? And what is right is what I wanted to persuade you is right. The two-state vector. And just a brief description of two-state vector. This is a standard one. And if we make a post-selection or measurement in the future, there is a backward evolving wave function the same, just going backward in time. And in between, on the same footing, given pre-selection, post-selection, everything described by two-state vector. Now, how this picture explains our results? This is a forward evolving wave function in this simple experiment. This is a backward evolving wave function in this experiment. You see, now let's go look on both of them. On this trajectory, in fact, Wheeler's trajectory, both forward and backward are present. So I say, where the both are present, this is where was the pre and post selected particle. Here there is only forward Ewald wave function, no backward. So it was not present here. We see only signal in B, no signal in A. In this case, this is a forward Ewald wave function. Now, this is a backward Ewald wave function. You remember, this one was tuned very carefully that everything which comes from here goes down. Everything is time reversal, that if now the backward splits here, now it doesn't come from here, it comes from here. It is tuned interferometer. It will not go here, it will go, everything will go this way. So now we can put them together, and then we see on this trajectory two-wave function, so of course Wheeler is fine, is correct about this. But also two-wave function inside the inner interferometer. So the particle was here and inside the interferometer. And that's exactly what we saw in our experiment. We saw this frequency and this frequency. This was wiggling, but we didn't see it because here the photon was not present. He couldn't tell us about this frequency. He could tell only about frequency where the photon was. Also about E. E is a backward Ewald wave function, is not present. We need two of them to get it. Okay. some other kind of approach, or philosophy. As I said, from my point of view, the past of an object is where it left a trace. This is where everyone will say some elementary particle was in a bubble chamber. However, for quantum particles, if I want to know where was the particle inside interferometer, the bubble chamber is not a good idea. Because it's strong measurement, it tells me exactly what's happening. I cannot use strong measurement. I should talk about weak measurement or weak trace it leaves. I believe that when photon goes, it makes some weak interaction with something local here. It changes its wave function not to be orthogonal, it changes it very little. I believe everywhere where the particle is, there is this change. And where the particle is not, there is no this change is not present. So In this place, nothing changed whatsoever. Here, it was some weak trace was left. So the weak traces are really the past of the particle. More generally, if I want to use this weak two-state vector formalism, the general result, if you have pre- and post-selected system, that every variable which couples weakly to the system, effectively couples to this weak value. So where the projection is not zero, this is where the particle is. Or where any kind of local operator is not zero, then this is where the particle is. We can make one Neumann measurement, and then we can really see that the real part, the imaginary part, but this is now not the main issue of the talk. It's not zero when this two-state vector is not zero. In this experiment, if we look on the projection operators, the projection operators in A, B, and C are not zero because we have two wave functions. If we look on E and F, one of them is not present. So automatically, when we put projection on E on F, these things will give us zero. So there is no weak value of anything, any local operator in this place.
Zero divided by zero.
No, not zero. The wave function, this is psi prepared. Psi, because of C, we have psi and phi. Here, just put projection. The psi is my original state. In fact, I will look at it again. But psi is what was prepared, it's a red one. And phi is what was found. So the scalar product is not zero, it's finite, it's 1 over 6, whatever, 1 over 9, something like this. And here I just put a, if I want to be really, to write it down correctly, the time, for example, at f, I'm here. So I look on this wave function at here, the post-selected has some amplitude here and here, the pre-selected has some amplitude here, the scalar product is not there. But the projection here is there. Okay, so I believe that the weak trace is only where the two-wave function, so this is where the wave, where the particle was in this experiment. And we can look maybe even a little more semantics. Just look at this particular time, the particle, this is the time I arranged at the same time they reach both all these mirrors, A, B, and C. The forward-evolved weak wave function, in fact, can be written in this simple form. And the backward evolving wave function, I will have also a simple form, slightly different. And this is really familiar case of C-box, sometimes C-box paradox. So I prepared in A plus B plus C, and I find it, the photon which reached there, I found it in A minus B plus C. So in A and C, it's completely symmetric. If somebody tells that it's C, on this, exactly on the same footing, it should be in A. At weak values, in A is 1, in C is 1, in B is minus 1. In fact, this three-box experiment without this other part was done by Steinberg a while ago, 10 years ago, and they have seen these weak values. Now, what I essentially what I can look on this experiment also as a weak measurement, and I got 1, 1, and 1, and not minus 1. This you probably can tell me why I didn't get minus 1. Steinberg did, I didn't. I vote on power spectrum. Power spectrum doesn't see the sign. So, the minus 1, I have to look. What's happening here? When I move C, this goes up. When I move A, let's say it also goes up. When I move B, if in a normal way, it should go up. Because of this minus 1, I will see that it will go down. This is the meaning of weak value equal minus 1. That action here really causes an opposite effect. But since I see the, I see just spectrum of the signal, I would not see the difference between minus 1 and plus 1. Okay. So, how future measurement affect the present? If I make a range, this is my present. If I make the measurement as I did, the set of possible outcomes, I could get a photon here, and photon here. If I get a photon here, I get this two-state vector which I talked with this strange weak trace. If I could get also the photon here, the weak trace in fact will be similar, also strange, more or less the same. And I can get a photon here, the story will be different. It will not be in C at all. It will be only inside inner interferometer. So that this, my possible, if I decide to make this measurement, that these are possible presents. My possible presence. However, I can make another decision. Instead of putting the range, I can move my detectors here. If I move my detectors here, I will never get this strange figure. I can get click here, here, or here. In this way, the weak trace will be here, or here, or here. So I can change sets of possible weak traces for present. Now I'm here, this is the time. I still can make a decision to put these detectors here or to leave the detectors which was before. By this, possible presence will be changed. And now, I can, there are other interesting things. I can change what, you know, I once named elements of reality. Similar to EPR, something which we know for certainty, which come out with certainty, then I call it elements of reality. The difference is that in standard one, if we can predict with certainty, and here I say infer, because I take into account pre-selection and post-selection. This is kind of counterfactual. The truth was kind of complaining about them. And these elements of reality, I try to put every time kind of in quotation marks. I don't think that this is not this elements of reality. EPR used this name, and so I use this name. It's not reality. Reality is a wave function. This really, if I will look, I will find it. This is very common to consider this reality. And some interesting reality in this example, which just considered, is a three box example. Arranging this A plus B plus C and possibility to find A plus B minus C, I arrange kind of elements of reality which is strange. Both I know for certainty that it's in A and in B. In the sense that if I look in A, I will find it with certainty. If I look in B, I will find it with certainty. It's counterfactual, so whatever can... It's just this definition. For me, it's important because I have all kinds of theorems. If I know elements of reality, then I immediately can calculate weak values. Because if strong value is known for certainty for measurement, then the weak value equals strong value. Weak value for me, it's much more reality, what I call sometimes weak measurement of reality. In this, when I prepare it, this state and find this state, here will be some trace, weak trace, really weak trace. See, environment will be changed exactly according to this story. So there is this weak measurement of reality is really written in nature. A strong element of reality is just really counterfactual. If I will measure, I'll find it. Again, I can by future measurement can change possible sets of elements of reality. Putting just detectors here, here, and here will tell me that the elements of reality one will be simple. It's either here, here, or here. In the previous example, the reality was this and this together in one case. Now they are all separated, not strange. With spin, I think this example already been shown once. I have a choice. I can prepare a spin up in Z direction. Then later I can measure its spin Z direction. Then the elements of reality is the only which I have. It's just that spin in Z direction has elements of reality, is well defined. Instead, I can measure sigma x in the future. Then there are two elements of reality. The value of sigma z and sigma x. What's interesting is that in some way I can make sigma z, sigma x, and sigma y. However, for the price. What I say, the description is two-state vector. There is also the concept of generalized two-state vector, superposition of two-state vectors. To get superposition of two-state vectors, this is an effective concept when I have my system entangled to another system. This is my system entangled to another system. And I protect other systems that nobody will touch it. Then this system can be described effectively for any measurement by superposition of two-state vectors. This is kind of a way to prepare any superposition I want. I have to prepare an entangled state and make a measurement with entangled eigenstates, composite measurement. For example, to get sigma x, sigma y, sigma z, elements of reality, and in this case, every time. In previous example, I got this strange trace only in one outcome. Here, whatever happened, if I start with this state and measure operator, which has these eigenvalues, then always, whatever will happen, I will get this generalized two-state vector for my spin, provided I don't touch the other one. And I will have, depending on the outcome, I will have always three elements of reality simultaneously for all of them. Sigma x, sigma y, sigma z will be known whatever outcome this of the future measurement will be if I will make this measure. So sigma, I can make all of them together with certainty. So this is kind of I'm now in present, I prepared my spins and I'm interested in elements of reality. If I want to, I can make this complicated measurement and then I will know for certainty sigma x, sigma y, sigma z, elements of reality. Maybe another example, the entanglement swapping, which was made and by a group of Zeilinger, and he decided in the future what We had these entangled pairs, and then these two particles were together, and we could in the future decide if to measure it in a Bell measurement, or then these two will be entangled. So if the present is now, by future measurement, I can make these two particles, which were not entangled, entangled, if I want to. Or I can make measurement on each one separately, and then they will not be entangled. So this, again, this is kind of entanglement considered important. I can I can change in the present entanglement. This is given protection. It's only if I consider these two particles. Really, there is a two-state vector for four particles, and there is a backward evolving wave function for these two, because these are, are not measured yet. So only given the protection, given kind of special idea that I don't consider this, with the idea that I don't look on it, then I can say entangled, not entangled, with some constraints. So future measurement affects the interpretation of the result of weak measurement. This is what we had by James. Robust weak measurement. This is the example we just considered. So in my case, I consider spin spin equal 20. And I measure it, I prepare it first up. Let's say it's y. Then, now, just a little before the present, I perform a weak measurement in 45 direction. In fact, here it's enough one, and this measurement will give me some, the uncertainty in my measurement is really something about 4, and I get 28. 4 I know, because the width of my measuring device is such that it tells me the accuracy, the uncertainty is 4, and the outcome is 28. This happened, I prepared in y direction, made a measurement in this direction, I got this outcome. This is my present. Now I can change, in a sense, something about this present. One way, one option is that I will later will measure spin in x direction. If I measure it in x direction, there is a chance that I will get Sx equal 20. If Sx equal 20, then 28 is just a weak value of spin in 45 direction. And this is really, then I will say, oh, my measuring device had this distribution. In fact, this is a simulation of this this example. This is a distribution far away from 20. Then this value 28, it's very, it just represents the result of weak measurement in pre-selection and post-selection. Of course, I'm not sure that this will happen. I might not get Sx equal 20. Most probably I will not get it. But there is a chance that I will get Sx equal 20. If I get a chance, then the interpretation of this outcome, okay, it's just the good result of weak measurement. Instead, I can, even I got this kind of strange phenomena for this measurement, I will measure spin in the same direction later. When I measure Sy, whatever I will get, no way to get spin weak value of spin in this direction 28. It will always will be below 20, much below 20, probably below 14. So then, when I make, if my decision to measure spin later in the same direction, like the preparation one, then the only way to consider the these outcomes as an error. Error of the experiment. So I can, this is my possibility to change the present.
What was the spin of this object?
What?
What spin is this? What kind of object is this?
I don't know. It's a particle with a spin equal, it's spin equal 20. I don't know.
The total spin is 20.
Yeah, the total spin is 20, yes. The total spin is 20. Not that I know about such a particle, but again, I can do it with 20 spin, or maybe 40. I think this was really made for 20 spin half particles, and the sigma really. Okay. Okay. So, future measurement cannot affect description of macroscopic systems. Cannot change every record which we have, we cannot change it. What it can affect description of microscopic particles, such as elements of reality, entanglement, etc. Again, we cannot make it for sure that it will be this or this, but we can make different future measurements will tell us it will be some different sets of these concepts. We can make that some of the things might could be elements of reality or could not be on some, and the sigma x, sigma y, and sigma z have a robust measurement. Every time we can arrange that in the future sigma x, sigma y, and sigma z are elements of reality, known with certainty if measured. The weak trace in environment, weak measurement elements of reality, I think this is the most important thing. We can, by measuring, putting this future measurement, we know that the weak traces will have certain pattern, certain possible patterns. Sometimes I call it weak measurement set of elements of reality, something which you see only by when you look weakly on your system. Interpretation of the results of measurement. I think this here, we had a robust outcome. We knew we got this 28, it was classical. And but deciding of what we will measure next, the interpretation of this outcome, well, we can be changed. I didn't mention many words, which of course this is a framework which I'm much easier for me to think. Clearly, I can future measurement can split words in different ways, and when we talk about classical objects, this splitting will be after the measurement, because for classical object the psi and phi are the same because of the coherence. For quantum objects, for particles which we want to describe, like particles inside interferometer, whatever, the present is described by the future measurement. So my future measurement change the two-state vector description now of my microscopic particles. Again, so this is for every word I can inside the word I can have I have these influences. What I want to add that if I look about everything together, God's view, many word interpretation and super technology which can see on all words together, then for God there is no such interesting phenomena. I arrange here, I can see the strange trace, which is really strange. God will not see it. Why God will not see it? God will see all outcomes together. There is this word, where is it? This word and this word, there will be these strange pictures. But in this word, there will be some other picture. Now he sees all of them together. When he sees all of them together, this is really the wave function he sees. The forward and the backward are the same. If we take this click, and this click, and we put everything backward in time, there will be nothing going here, because there will be destructive interference of from this to one. So what we'll get in a backward evolving wave function, exactly the forward evolving wave function. So ontologically, there is only one, going forward and backward. From God's only psi is ontic. Now, phi is very much important for us. We live every time in particular world, we get some particular result. For us, phi is important, as psi. Given some particle, prepared in psi, and I found it in particular measurement, for me, phi has the same status as psi. Not for nature, which looks on all of them together. So, from God's point of view, the future measurement cannot affect anything, because the same psi, it's just all the same psi, forward or backward. And I just may I abuse maybe the time of the conference. Yakira Anwar was not here, but he founded a new journal, which I believe will be good for the audience to submit papers. I'm editor, Sandu is editor, Jeff is a managing editor. Anybody else here? I think no. So, and it's mathematical and foundation, so papers in philosophy on quantum mechanics. I submitted one in my views just for the first issue. And also mathematical consideration of ontology of the wave function. I think this is really important. Very welcome. Thank you.